So Becca, I'd like to start too by saying how beautiful you look today. You do look stunning, and I'll say it because I know you're all thinking, John is punching well above his weight, isn't he? John and Becca would like to say thank you too to the wonderful Ivona who's planned this whole thing. She's over there and all the staff here. So now, John, some of you may know John really, really well, some not so well. Some may have sneaked in because you thought you'd seen Alec Jones in a suit heading for a party, or because you heard that the occasional voice of Business Matters on the World Service was coming on, and thought of the perfect opportunity for a selfie. If so, just make sure you get in before he spilled red wine down his shirt. I mean, always. Every single night out, always red wine down his shirt. We started dancing to cheesy 80s music. We'll come back to the dancing later. Now, I first met John in Jersey. No, not New Jersey. The Jersey you've probably never heard of. The tiny channel island just off the coast of Paris. Tiny point. Very nice place. Where we both work for the BBC. Well, I mean, I say work. I arrived shortly after John. He was very welcoming. I was unsure. I'll be honest, he was overly enthusiastic. But we ended up living in the same block of flats, the glamorous sounding Bully Bay Apartments. And they were far from glamorous, let me tell you. And mind you, John's did boast a roof terrace, although you and I would probably just call it the flat roof of the building below, accessed by a window. But nonetheless, John absolutely loved it. In fact, we once had a barbecue on the roof terrace. John put the disposable barbecue on the flat roof and almost killed the people in the building below. My flat didn't have a roof terrace, or indeed running water in the kitchen sink, or any square inch of the carpet without a stain or central heating. But hey, it was home, and it was expensive because it was Jersey. Came with a retirement of a landlady too, who seemed to absolutely love John and let him away with murder and hated me. Apparently objecting to washing dishes in the bath was unreasonable. John got on with it. I think we really bonded though, John and I, when one day our slightly strange editor called us into his suite. Sorry, guys. And asked us to take over the second biggest of the two local breakfast shows on the island. John's... John had a starring role as a producer, travel reader and sports presenter, and well, I just did the bits in between. Yes, John reading sport. John who still thinks that Fred Perry is Wimbledon champion reading sport. Luckily, as I said, it was the second biggest of the two breakfast shows on the island, so nobody really noticed. Well, from there was no looking back. But the BBC was by far from the start of John's glittering media career. Although I'm apparently not allowed to mention the halcyon days of Bruno Brooks' post-Radio 1 empire, where John presented the National Breakfast Show, piped to a select few newsagents and convenience stores across the UK. But still, he's national, and he's big in Bradford, he's massive in Montalabe. He's huge in Hereford, still. Becca has to go in and buy his weekly family-sized bag of onion rings because, you know, amongst owners of Longest and Crosscutter, John can't move. He's also very proud of his early presentation days on Mix 96 in Aylesbury, where he grew up. Cassettes that hold the evidence. I've tried so many times to get them, and fiercely protected. Before all of that, though, John went to Aylesby Grammar School, where school friends tell me he was pretty much the same as he is now. Even apparently with the same haircut. And even then, he had a strange obsession for local radio frequencies and mask locations. So, then on to LMH at Oxford, where he was known for being a smooth-talking, well-dressed man about town. Well, that's what he says anyway. I'm told by his friends that he was constantly infamous for bumping into people after four whiskeys on a dance floor and causing trouble that they didn't want to be involved with. After sending dodgy messages into teletext that would appear on the screen and to a copy of the room. But really, all of this was just building up to meeting the lovely Becca. John and Becca, as Becca said, A first date of drinks and dinner at the Otto Tower. No, it's flashy now. John also had his 30th birthday there, which was just a big show off, you really. I asked Becca what she thought of John on the first date, and when she finally told Katie the same thing, she replied, yeah, he'll do. It's like a Milton Boone novel, isn't it? But she did point out that he kept getting better from there, and she said she knew that he was the one when he agreed to a sailing holiday. For all of you who know John, wouldn't you love to be there to watch him on it? Say, can you imagine him sailing a boat? Martin, can you give her that video camera so that if they do that in the future, we can all share the video? And whilst Becca was in the mood for exposing, I asked her what most annoyed her about John. I'm helping, because at least now this is in the open, so you don't have to be in an awkward state. John, it's your, and I'm quoting now, ridiculous expression of an American accent. I mean, quite frankly, she could have chosen from a long list of things, like his inability to do anything practical, or his desire to always travel by public transport, even when the car is just quicker, or his abnormal love of eggs. The man is obsessed with eggs, anything egg-based products. Do you know that in the early noughties, he actually set up an egg blog? Still be found on the internet now. He sets up a blog about egg and I quote, the virtues of egg-based products. Egg-based is a man to tour the country and lives in the best stock chairs.
Honestly, it's gone, so you're bored now.
For the fact he puts his hand to his nose every time he laughs. John does laugh a lot, even if it's sometimes completely inappropriate. And that's what's brilliant about John. He's funny, he's kind, he's generous, he's merry. He can't tell a joke for toffee, but to be honest, that just makes it funnier. He can organise a piss-up in a brewery on the face of it, but somehow he consistently pulls it off, and he's always there when you need him most. And I'm sure all of you would say that. He's just a constant in so many people's lives, providing so much support and care. And Becky said, she said in her speech, what she loves most, because I felt I had to ask, because that's what was most annoying, so I thought, better ask what she likes. It's his kindness and patience in the face of any obstacle, and that pretty much sums up John. We're almost at the end, and I've not even mentioned, so because apparently you need anecdotes of these things. I've not even mentioned our trip to Tenby years ago. Come to think of it, we have taken a lot of spiky old trips, but quite frankly, you look like an old camp married couple. That's all right. John had done some research, you see, and he claimed that Tenby was, and I quote, the stag capital of the UK. Yes, Tenby, the tiny seaside town in Wales. Anyway, we arrived, we checked into this very old pink B&B that John referred to as very old, four duvets, two single beds separated by a little bedside cupboard, slightly too low for comfort. We went to the only bar in town, and we were the only two there, literally. I mean, it was cavernous, this place. It was the size of this, we were the only two people there. And the DJ was rocking out in the corner to dance music at full pelt behind laser lights flickering all over the dance floor. Turns out the article John found dated back to 1990. So we decided to, the next day, move on to the metropolis of Swansea, where the place he'd booked turned out to be a bail hostel, and when we got there it was covered in police tape because somebody had just died in one of the rooms inside. We ended up in Cardiff where I got food poisoning from a pizza hut and we retired to our suite in the future. And to be fair, all we did was laugh all weekend. Oh, and I know John Ross is here tonight, like he's on camera duty, so I'd like to point out that he is a good journalist. His research skills are much more polished now. Much more polished. I've also not mentioned the time that we tried camping, which was my first time, and it was John's kind of quest to get me to go camping. We went to, woke up so crippled, hungover, and with an overwhelming desire to leave that we drove off in search of breakfast, leaving our tent and all of our camping equipment behind. And whilst John was guiding me to make a 3-point turn to get out of the campsite, knocked over a family's barbecue and all of their breakfast cooking. And then like really bad people just left. All the time we spent a week on the Amalfi Coast with John insisting we rode an open-top bus in the rain. Tour bus. Or when during his bachelor days he gatecrashed, sorry, decided to join my wife, then girlfriend and I on a romantic holiday to Turkey.
Oh, and a stag!
Sorry, stags, typical job. Two stags. One in Vegas, one in Oslo, but I've not mentioned them. Nothing happened in either. Nothing. We went to bed with an early meal, or we went to bed with a coke, that's it. Oh, and I said, going back to the dancing. Well, you lucky lot, you're about to see something very, very special. You see, very special. John will throw shapes and sing along when a jingly lights comes on the radio. So, God only knows what it'll be like tonight, because he's picked the playlist. So, stand by, you're in for a treat, and also stand clear if you don't want a black eye. If you've got the occasion coming up, just don't dance close, because his fear's quite vigorous. John, I met you, you're a fantastic couple. You're so, honestly, utterly comfortable in each other's company. You bring a lot of joy to the lives of those around you. So I wish you every happiness for your life together and all of the fun and excitement that I know it'll hold. So ladies and gentlemen, charge your glasses and raise your toast. Right through.
Thank you, Joe.
Follow their plan.
and longer by far. How long will I hold you? As long as your father told you. As long as you are. How long will I give to you? As long as as long as stars are above you, longer if I may.